All right, Maddy Hudak from ESPN Radio, the dog days of summer. So what do? We get ready for the Saints. We talk about upcoming training camp. Let's start with, I think, the biggest topic, Jameis Winston. Are you buying Jameis leading this team to potentially the playoffs and maybe a Super Bowl?
I think all really Jameis has to do this year in comparison from last year is execute. I feel like the thing last year was he kind of had to make magic happen a lot more often than not. And this year, you look at the three receivers between Michael Thomas, Olave, and Jarvis Landry. Even if Thomas doesn't see the field week one, that comparative to last year is already such a huge difference. He'll have the entire offseason to actually, you know, be there as QB1 and have a full season to see kind of those growing pains out. So I think all of the chips are in a lot better position for him this year. I think I saw a lot of potential in him those first couple of weeks. I thought I saw him be more mobile than I guess I would have expected him to be. I did see him, you know, convert on third downs and step up when needed, but I think this year will really show us kind of what he can do as a quarterback. But I think all, again, he has to do is really execute, get first downs, let this defense rest for a bit. And with Will Lutz hopefully back at this point, you know, it might not have to be a touchdown. 3 points this year could be enough.
I think that there are parallels, just my opinion, between last year's 49ers, awesome defense, great skill guys, and Jimmy Garoppolo at quarterback. They were in the NFC Championship game. I don't think I'm selling Jameis short, but I agree with you. I think that if he is a really good game manager, this could be a really good team. Let's move on to Alvin Kamara. Reports are all over the place. I know NBC Sports, Mike Florio, reported that it could be up to 6 games, a possible suspension for what he's dealing with, the battery situation in Las Vegas. If it is 6 games, that's a significant loss for the New Orleans Saints. I love Mark Ingram, but losing Kamara for 6 games would be a huge blow to this offense, even with the weapons that they have.
Yeah, I mean, that suspension, and it seems like that happened so long ago at this point. It was before the Pro Bowl. And so looking kind of, again, at precedent and what these situations look like without any knowing, you know, any specifics, the fact that he was arrested for that battery charge, I always tend to look at the worst case scenario. So even if those 6 games aren't in week one, they could come at some point in the season. And I think I'm with you that I'm most concerned about the depth past him and the health of that room, because again, I don't think Kamara is going to need to do what he did necessarily last year and be, you know, the number one power running back and number one receiver simultaneously and depending on the game plan. But in terms of what they do to solve that, the only positive I can look at is this is a long season again, and that late bye week, it's either 13 or 14. To me, it's almost not a bye week at that point. It's just you're deciding to rest players before the playoffs. But one positive I could see out of this is if he does get suspended, they are able to kind of get through those couple games. His health probably should take him, you know, further this season than you would think having that time off.
You've done advanced legal studies. Do you like the fact, kind of more of a philosophical question, the NFL used to be judge, jury, and executioner before the legal process even played out. Do you like the fact that they've taken a little bit more of a hands-off approach and they do wait for things to play themselves out in the court now before taking action? I remember last year, everybody thought Marshawn Lattimore was going to be suspended. The situation is still not resolved in Ohio, so Marshawn Lattimore has faced no discipline. Do you like the shift the NFL has made instead of, I understand there's a code of conduct policy, but not just right away punishing people, letting it play out?
Yeah, because then you have to go through the appeals. It just seems like so much additional work when, like you said, when there are these court proceedings that are already playing out with non-biased parties, it's hard for me to, you know, really think that the independent investigators for the NFL are looking at this from a pure legal perspective straight down the middle. And if that's not the case, then again, why not just let proceedings already play out? And the thing with Lattimore is he actually did plead guilty to a lower charge. It was a misdemeanor, which was kind of lost in the shuffle last year because that was kind of what the expectation was. And it's not really something that the NFL, I think, would look at as a violation of their conduct policy. He pleaded guilty to the failure to inform about a concealed weapon. The thing that I think is different with Kamara is there is no, with Marshawn Lattimore, all of this, you know, still as allegations, it was harder to kind of prove his proximity to what they were charging him with than it was, you know, ultimately a nonviolent offense. Those two things are a little different with Kamara. So I think I do like the approach in general to wait and see and let, again, what's already happening in court play out. I think there's always times for exceptions, but in general, I think it is a more prudent approach. and one that I think just lets what already should play out, play out.
All right, moving on back to some on-field topics. The best battle of training camp that you'll be looking forward to, I'm going to be looking at left tackle. Is it Hurst or is it Penning, their first-round draft pick? I think it's going to be Penning, but I know Hurst has been a really capable backup the last couple of years. Is that the battle you're looking at, or do you have a best battle of training camp, so to say?
I'm really curious about CB2. I think it is Paulson Adebo's job to lose. That being said, you know, through OTAs and rookie minicamp, everything that came out about Alante Taylor really kind of bolstered that idea on draft night that a lot of the time Saints draft picks don't make, you know, immediate sense to people because they're not on their draft boards, for lack of a better term. But he's smart and he seems to be very coachable, and that's been something that head coaches and position coaches have touted. He has familiarity with people on the coaching staff and a lot of the players. And I just think that bringing in Tyrann Mathieu has really upped the sense of competition in that backfield. And, you know, you hear things about Thompson doing really well at safety with all kind of the base nickel packages that they have. They could even do dime at this point with the amount of defensive backs they have. But just in a pure, you know, who is opposite Marshawn Lattimore, I am really curious to see if that really becomes a battle.
Yeah, that's an interesting topic. You're right. Paulson Adebo last year was one of the rookie stars of this team. Let's talk about stars. Last year during training camp, Marquez Callaway became the training camp star. There's always that training camp darling, the guy who shines. I don't know if it always translates to the regular season. Is there somebody that you say, I think this person could be a breakout star in training camp? I'm going with Peyton Turner. I think that Peyton Turner was a first-round draft pick for a reason. He's got all the size and the strength and the measurables. I think it's going to be great competition on that defensive line where they have a ton of talent. But I think in training camp and preseason games, I think we're going to be talking a lot about him. Do you have somebody that you're kind of circling right now?
So I had a half a mind to say Peyton Turner, and then my only pause was if he's going to have the durability to, you know, be throughout training camp. My second option was then going to be Pete Werner, but that was kind of the same thing last year. I think he had an elbow injury, but he didn't have any, you know, long-standing issues with durability through this past season. So I think I would go him. I think it's interesting. I think defense wins a lot, especially early on in training camp while the offense is still kind of getting their bearings. And I just think, you know, the fact that Quan wasn't re-signed up to this point, Mario Davis is a very energetic person and likely needs that in his counterpart. So I could see him really stepping up into that void of kind of that mentality, but really just working on his smarts and his skill set that I thought also showed again from somewhat of an unknown rookie out of the draft last year.
All right, training camp is going to be great. The Saints will start the final week of July. One final question here. We've dipped into the legalese of things. The Saints not getting Deshaun Watson. It seems like that may be the best move of the offseason, given everything is still unfolding. It is certainly a situation in Cleveland that has been a distraction to them getting ready on the football field. Is that fair to say? And I know it was a controversial topic back in March when we had you in and we all talked about it. Is it fair to say that the best move they made this offseason may have been not getting Deshaun Watson and having to deal with what is an unfortunate situation, but that is still playing out and is a complete distraction in Cleveland?
It's hard for me to say anything but 100% yes, and I think you put it best as just the giant distraction on the field. And we could talk about, you know, what all the moral arguments are and the controversies all day, but one of the points I had brought up when you brought me and Kat on was I didn't understand it from a strategic standpoint either. You talk about Kamara potentially looking at six games. He's more than likely, you know, six games is the bare minimum to me at this point, considering he's moving through the process of settling at least 20 of them. And your starting quarterback and your starting running back both being suspended for at least six games or, you know, for one of them, but just having to have that conversation and then everything that comes with that. We don't know what the ultimate draft package would have been for the Saints, but just looking at what Cleveland gave up in terms of monetary compensation and draft picks, it's hard for me to not say that they're looking at that and having a little bit of buyer's regret. I just think that it's a situation that, again, when there's numbers of that magnitude, maybe, again, we talked about legal process is playing out, and I get that's incompatible with the game of football, but I think having the notion too that Jameis Winston canceled his flight to Indianapolis and came back and signed really quickly with the team, I think that really did a lot for kind of just bringing this team back to its barometers. And I think that the offense wants to, you know, play for Winston this year. You do get the sense that they want to fight for them because they did watch him fight on the field last year. And so I just think all of those things considered, the fact that, you know, the biggest distraction at this point is a potential suspension for Alvin Kamara, that's a lot different than what they're looking at in Cleveland.
All right. Maddy Hudak from ESPN Radio. Great insight as always.